Welcome to Mindful School Marketing, your go-to podcast for personal and professional growth.
We're school marketers, business owners, and moms passionate about connecting other school professionals with tools and strategies for success.
We love solving problems, exploring new ideas, and thinking outside the box. Let's transform your school and life starting right now. Welcome to Mindful School Marketing. I'm Aubrey Bursch.
And I'm Tara Clays. Today, we're joined by Roger Coles. Roger is the founder of My Social Designer, where he helps entrepreneurs and organizations create graphics in minutes with customizable Canva templates. You may have seen his work on the largest Bible app, YouVersion, or on Canva.com. He's passionate about his family, creativity, and becoming 1% better at something every day. Welcome, Roger. We're so glad you're here.
Hey, thank you for having me. I'm honored to be here talking with the two of you.
And Roger, I am so excited to dive into this topic today. But before we get started, I'd love to learn more about you and what you do. Could you tell us more about yourself?
Sure. Yeah. Okay. So I'm from Northern Virginia, born and raised. On the playground is where I spent most of my days. No, I'm just joking. I'm a husband, graphic designer based in the Washington, D.C. area. And I sort of just stumbled my way into design. It wasn't something that I had planned on. I didn't go to college for this. I didn't go to school for this. I actually went to school for religion. I went to Bible college. And so when I graduated, I started serving in my local church because they needed registrations designed and they needed, you know, website. At that time, it was MySpace was a big thing. So it was like, yeah, we need a MySpace page for the youth group. So I started dabbling with those kinds of things. And the youth pastor at the time, he showed me a few things in Photoshop. And, you know, within a few months, I had just blazed by him because I just dove fully into it and started learning everything that I could. And so then I started serving. They brought me on staff. And the last 15 years or so have been me serving in a church setting in some capacity, either ministry or a pastoral role, mostly within like the music and creative side of things, little bit of teaching. And so design was always something that was just something on the side that I would use to help kind of supplement our income, because when you're serving in a church, you're not making a whole lot of money. And so it was just a great way for me to take on clients and continue to, you know, learn a little bit more on that side of things. And then about 2 years ago, our church closed down. And so this thing that had been a side hustle became like the hustle, like it became the main thing. So I really started diving into learning more about business, learning more about marketing, trying to surround myself with other entrepreneurs who I could learn from, reading as many books as I could. Dr. Google and Professor YouTube, those became like my best friends. And so that's kind of my journey of how I got started into design. It kind of found me, I guess.
Yeah, I love that evolution. And I think, you know, your experience in churches is not unlike the experience that a lot of people who work in schools have. And a lot of the schools that we work with are part of a church community as well. So, You know, that sort of taking on those extra roles and learning a new skill as part of that. I'm sure that some of our listeners probably have been doing the same thing in their school where they've been given some kind of role for communications and they've had to figure out tools like Photoshop and Canva, which is not always easy, but those references that we have online certainly are helpful. No question about that. How did you kind of discover Canva and how has that changed your approach to design?
Yeah, Canva became something that I started probably a few years ago. And it was mainly because I would have clients who wanted a design that they wanted the ability to tweak. So instead of coming back to me because they wanted a comma added, because I made it in Photoshop, I would say, you know what, let me just go ahead and design this in Canva because you can use it for free and you'll be able to get in there and make any changes that you'd like.
And yeah, can I just interrupt and say, I didn't ask you this and I didn't say it, but for anybody who might not know, let's just kind of back up for a second and say what Canva is.
Yeah. Okay, so Canva was started by, I think her name's Mel Perkins, and she started it because she wanted to make design more accessible for people. So a designer understands Adobe and Photoshop and Illustrator, but someone who is not well versed in that world, they needed something more accessible. So they started this online design platform where you didn't have to download any kind of software. They made it available for free, and they started stocking the library with templates that were easy for people to customize. So these were templates made by designers. So the font pairing is already there, the colors are already there, and all you have to do is change the text or match the colors to your specific brand kit. And so they wanted to make it very accessible, and it's only exploded. I think this year they have a valuation of about $15 billion. And so they've exploded in the last year, and the things that they've got in the roadmap, y'all, there's some exciting stuff coming.
I'm on the edge of my seat because I love Canva. We use it, I mean, all the time for clients and for just our business. So I'm excited.
Yeah. It's going beyond just social media graphics. There's going to be it's going to be really big for video. They've got some cool stuff rolling out for even website design. So if someone is a little bit nervous about jumping into WordPress, Squarespace, there's going to be the ability for you to do something directly through Canva. So a lot of cool stuff.
Yeah. Well, and it makes design more accessible and easier too. I know things like font pairings. I talk a lot about, you know, people choosing bad pairings or fonts that don't look professional. So to have that kind of set up for you is really, really helpful and can help your, make your stuff look really professional without knowing what you're doing, right?
For sure. Yep. I see so many designs and I'm just like, oh, what are you doing? Start with a template.
Comic Sans.
If you don't know where to go, start with a template.
Yeah, I think Canva is probably one of the game changer. I mean, it disrupted the space, right? I just think it did, because you were right. Before, you would have to go to Photoshop, or you would have to like hire someone who knew what they were doing in those programs if you didn't know what you were doing in those programs. Yeah. And now it's just opened the doors for so many people to just, you know, be able to create, right? It's not holding them back anymore.
Exactly.
And especially for a lot of the people that I work with and our audience are small school leaders, and they don't have the budget to hire people to do all those sorts of things. And to be able to, you know, I have Canva Business and it is a low fee for what you get. And so it's accessible for more and more people. So that's great to hear they're expanding. I'm curious to hear your thoughts on, you know, as people are, you know, getting to know, like thinking about Canva, what are the biggest obstacles to them actually starting and using it, or challenges that you see?
Yeah, I think with anything, any new software, even if you get a new phone, there's that like initial learning curve. So the thing that I usually recommend is that Canva has a design school. So you can just like Google it, Canva Design School, and they give you very like bite-sized videos that you can watch to kind of help onboard you in all of the different tools that you have available. So I've run into the same thing where, you know, I sell templates and people are like, I love your templates, but I don't know anything about Canva. And so one of the things that I offer when someone does download one of my templates, I actually have tutorials in there that I'll show you how to use them. So that's like one simple way. But then aside from that, if you just want to know how to use Canva, they've made it so easy. So that's what I would recommend to people. The challenges that they have is just understanding things like the toolbar, understanding how to add something like a brand kit, that's so crucial. And if you have the pro, I think you can do it for free, but maybe it's really limited on how many colors you can add into your brand kit. But if you have the pro version, you can add a bunch of different brand kits. So when I'm working on a client's project that says, hey, I want custom Canva templates, I actually add their brand kit. I'll add their brand fonts. So then when I'm creating something, I have that in my styles tab and I can literally just click on that and it'll change all the colors to match their brand kit. Same thing with fonts. So yeah, I think those are some of the challenges at first, is just understanding things like the toolbars and all the different features. But start small, you know, start with like, okay, I'm going to watch these three videos. You know, don't overwhelm yourself. Just start small and then you'll gradually become more educated about how to use it.
Yeah, it's such a great tool. And the fact that it's in the cloud so you can share it. And I mean, compared to Adobe for pricing, it's just an amazing resource for anyone and for schools specifically. Before we started recording, you were telling us a little bit about the education component of Canva. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, Canva loves education. They love educators. And I'm a part of a Canva creator program. They invited me to be a part of this last year, where they're kind of tapping designers to help create templates that you're now seeing in the library. And educators are a big segment of the creator program. And so these people are educators themselves who also understand how design works, and they're creating templates, different spreadsheets, worksheets that you can use. They've even thought through slides, presentations that you might want to use as you're teaching. There's math drills, algebra. There's so many different things that you can tap into. So yeah, they're a huge proponent for education.
Is there anything specific that schools should consider, anything different that might be helpful to them as they're thinking about how to integrate Canva into their marketing?
Yeah, I think like social media is probably one of the biggest uses for Canva. So even other designers that I talk to, they might still do some stuff in Photoshop, and then they go, yeah, but for all my social stuff, I use Canva. And so I think that's like, that would be a big one, is tapping into the Instagram posts, Instagram stories. There's Facebook posts. If you're running ads, they have Facebook ads. So there's so many templates available that schools could use. And then, you know, taking a step back from that in a more strategic sense is thinking about your content. So as a school, understanding who your target is, understanding the demographic that you're trying to reach. And then for me, what I've done is on my Instagram, you'll see a lot of the same categories, you know, so some people call them buckets. I call them pillars. I have about 3 to 5 different pillars that you're going to see on my page. It's going to be, I'm going to talk about Canva. I'm going to talk about creativity. I'm going to talk about entrepreneurship. I'm going to talk about social media. And then the fifth one is kind of loose in there, but music's a big part of what I like to use on my Instagram page as well. So if you can take a step back from just like, let me just make a graphic, but be more strategic in, okay, well, who are we trying to reach? What are the things that are important to who we are, our core values, and where do those intersect with our audience? And then you can open up Canva, and now you're not just randomly making graphics that you're like, I hope this gets a like, or I hope that this draws attention and, you know, our admissions team becomes really busy, but being more strategic in what you're creating before you even jump into Canva, I think is a huge help.
Yeah, for sure. That planning, I know we'll ask you about mindfulness in a few minutes, but I want to kind of go down this route a little bit too about the content. And when you're sharing images and things online and you're maybe quickly producing things where you could have typos, or if you're pulling an image off of Google, can you talk a little bit about what not to
do? Oh, yeah. I mean, there's so many things not to do. Even I was playing a game on my phone, and it was literally a brain game. An advertisement came up for talking about these exercises that you can do to help with Alzheimer's. And they were like, it really helps with memory. I was like, yo, this is a brain game and you spelled memory wrong. Like, typos matter.
That's so true that immediately people dismiss that. They're like, oh, no, not gonna click on that.
Yeah, this is not a trusted source for helping my brain get sharper. So yeah, I mean, I would say, on social media, some of the things to look for are those obvious things. Like, it's so easy to get really, really busy. I think practicing restraint and taking things out and using negative space, using white space, what happens is you start creating a graphic that you're going to post and you're just like, oh, it needs a little extra sauce. It needs a little this. And then by the time you're done, it's not even able to communicate the message that you want because there's so much visually going on that it's just distracting from the message. So I would say, like, use restraint, slowly add things in. I know some designers that will design in black and white first, so they won't even think about colors. I personally like to start with typography first. So what is the message, focusing on visual hierarchy? So if you're using Canva and you don't understand font pairings, here's a little tip for you. On the toolbar on the left-hand side, click on the button that says text, and there are already pre-made text layouts for you. Canva has already done the work for you with different font pairings, so you can start there if you don't understand how font pairings work as you're starting to educate yourself on visually what is going to work in the market.
I love what you just said there, because I feel like sometimes when we go down the rabbit hole of like creating things, we're like, oh yeah, let's just throw in a few more things. Oh, and I could make this animated and I could do all this stuff without backing up and saying, you know, strategically looking at it as how am I going to convey the end goal of this piece, right? Like, and the messaging and everything surrounding that, because we can get carried away. And I've been guilty of that too.
Yeah, we all do.
It's so good. It's very tempting. So I would like to switch gears a little bit through the lens of our podcast. You know, we talk about mindfulness and how it applies to people who work in schools. I love your intro where you describe yourself as being passionate and becoming 1% better at something every day. And that's so important, right? Yeah. I would love to know how you think mindfulness applies to social media graphics and the creation, social media creation.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, I'll start with the 1% better thing. That's something that I just, you know, I'm reading through. Well, maybe I won't. We're going to talk about this later probably. So I won't give too much preview on that. But I'm reading through a book right now that talks about that. And I've adopted that into my life. When you look at your house, sometimes there's things that you're like, man, that whole bathroom needs to be renovated, or I want like all new appliances. And then at the same time, you've got like light bulbs that are out in the bathroom. And so what I've started doing is I'm looking at my house as going like, what's something I can do to make it 1% better today? Okay, I can change that light bulb. Okay, there's some cobwebs around like the ceiling fan. Let me tackle that before I'm like, let me rip this out and rip that out. And we're going to have people in here banging out walls and stuff. Like, let's start with the small things. And I've started to try to let that bleed over into all areas of my life. So with my family, how can I be a 1% better husband to my wife? How can I be a 1% better dad today? You know, better today than I was yesterday. And I think that's much more manageable for people, because when we think about all of the big tasks that we have to complete, it can paralyze us and we don't do anything, because we're like, if I can't do that, oh, well, I guess I just won't do anything. But if you take it a day at a time, 1% at a time, man, at the end of the year, you probably look like a whole different person, even though it doesn't feel like it. But if you look back at your life, you're able to say, wow, I've come so far because of those small changes that made a huge impact over time. So I would say when it comes to being mindful about social media, that so many people are looking at the metrics. I'll never get to 20,000 followers, or right now 10,000 followers is a big one, because everybody wants that swipe up link. Like, oh man, I'm stuck at like 6,000 or whatever. That becomes the metric for success, when really it should be something smaller than that. And how are you nurturing the audience that you do have? I've heard people say it this way. If you had, let's say you've got 100 followers. Well, if you had 10 followers, let's translate that into real life. You had 10 people show up to your house to listen to something that you had to say. That's like a lot of people. And then 100 is like a small conference of people who showed up because they wanted to hear what you had to say. So even looking at your audience through that lens, instead of saying, I only have 100 followers, you have 100 people who showed up because they were interested in what you had to say. So take advantage of that. And you can slowly grow that audience over time. But if you're not nurturing the audience that you do have, then you can't really expect to grow to that 10,000, 20,000 and above milestone.
Yeah, that's true. I think that's really true. And when I think about our school audience, when I think about your 1% and, you know, kind of throwing everything out, it can be so overwhelming, especially we're coming up into a season where the school year is going to be transitioning or is transitioning. When you're in that type of a situation, or you see that there's a break coming up, you kind of see it as an opportunity to rip everything apart and, you know, redo the bathroom or redo your whole strategy for your social media. And you don't have to do that, right? You can take it one step at a time. And I appreciate all the template information that you shared, because it makes it less overwhelming for people to know that Canva, because sometimes you can jump into that and just try to do everything from scratch. But when you know that there are all these things built into it, it makes it feel a lot more approachable and doable. We ask some questions of all of our guests. So we're going to start asking you now, what are the most important things that you do to grow professionally and personally, Roger?
Okay. Professionally is just, I always have a book. I'm always reading something. And I feel like you're only ever one good book away from a breakthrough. So whenever I'm struggling with something, or I see something in myself that I just feel like, man, this is like a real weakness that I just keep running up against, I try to find a good book. And then of course, talking to friends, being a part of a mastermind has been huge, both professionally and personally for me, because we don't just talk about business, we talk about life as well. So we'll talk about things that we're struggling with. There are some masterminds that I'm like, yo, like my pipes are going crazy. I had the plumbers come in, they did the wrong thing. Now it's gonna be like twice the cost. I mean, that's like, you're expecting to talk about like, oh, okay, well tell me about your email marketing campaigns, but life just seeps into all of that stuff. So my mastermind has been a great way for me to grow both professionally and personally, and then always trying to find ways to become better by reading books is a big part of my growth.
Yeah, I think I appreciate what you said about the mastermind, because I've been part of some as well. And if you don't allow yourself to know each other and be vulnerable with each other, you're not going to get anything out of it, because you can't just go in there and pretend that you have it all figured out. And part of that is what's happening in your personal life. And some days you show up and yeah, your pipes have burst, or, you know, something has happened and you can't not talk about it. So it's really important in a group like that to share. And I would assume that school administrators have their own, you know, sets of masterminds and associations and head of school groups and that type of thing. I'm sure it's similar for them as well.
Yeah, I hope so. We all need that.
Absolutely. And I do know, working with a lot of heads of school, there has been a lot, especially during COVID. They needed to share. They needed that outlet, similar to what you were talking about with your mastermind. It was to bounce ideas off of one another, but it was also to show up and be able to say, I had a really tough day, or I want to quit, you know, because there are always going to be days like that in whatever business, profession, you know, school that you're in. So thank you very much for sharing that. Our second question is, what is one of the most important things we can do to be more mindful?
I think that slowing down is a big part of being mindful. It's usually not until maybe the end of the day when I'm laying my head down at night that I start to think, did I spend enough time with my daughter today? Whereas if I had slowed down a little bit during the course of my day, I could have done something about it. I can't really do anything about it at midnight when she's asleep and I'm going to bed. It's a little late in the day to think about it, so I could do something about it the next day. But I think that just taking the time to slow down and not be so in our own heads and have so many tasks that we're not thinking about the most important things. So giving space, I think, to be mindful and think about what is most important to me in life.
For sure. I have a hard time slowing down. And I think we've talked to other guests about that too, you know, kind of stepping away and taking that time. But when you're caught up in some productive moment, it's hard to walk away for me anyway. So I appreciate that.
Yeah. That's something I'm working on for sure.
Yeah. Okay. I've got rapid fire questions for you. Are you ready?
Let's go. Come on.
All right, here we go. What is a book that's had an impact on you that you would include in a high school curriculum?
Oh, Don't Sweat the Small Stuff by Richard Carlson. That was a game changer for me, and I'm so mad that I didn't read it earlier in life.
I love that. I don't think we've had that one mentioned before. So that is a good one to add to our book list.
Yeah, so good. I mean, just and very practical. The chapters are so small, so it's digestible information and just really practical things like choose being kind over being right. Make peace with imperfection. And he talks about like he's never met an absolute perfectionist whose life was filled with inner peace, because the two kind of conflict with one another. And reminding yourself that life isn't an emergency. And it's easy to get so agitated and worked up over things like someone cutting us off in traffic or a self-created deadline that it can derail the whole day. Just one small thing can derail the whole day. So a lot of the book is focusing on just those practical ways that you can be a better human and live life with less stress.
Yeah. And I think knowing yourself too, right? Understanding where you're coming from, it helps you approach a situation like that. Yeah. That's a great book. I'm definitely going to look forward to putting that on our list.
Yeah. It's a good one.
Great. All right. So rapid fire question number two.
Bring it.
Dun, dun, dun. what are you reading right now?
Okay. I alluded to this earlier in the conversation. I'm reading Atomic Habits. I think it's James Clear. I always get the authors. Like, I'm not sure.
Yep, it is.
Yeah.
One of my favorites.
Yeah, I'm going like slowly through that one. So sometimes I'll just do like, okay, I'm going to read it for like 5 minutes in the morning. It's a long game because there's so much to process in that book. There's so many good things. And so my wife actually is going through it as well, and it's been really helpful for us to have conversations about different things that we see that we want to work on.
Yeah, my husband read it soon after I did as well. And it does, it gets to that sort of 1% idea, right? Where you just take things in little bites instead of trying to tackle a huge, change your whole entire self.
Yeah.
So yeah, I love that book. I get his emails. I'm a
Same.
disciple of James
His
Clear for
Thursday
sure.
emails are so good.
Yeah, that's great.
I do love that book too. I made the mistake of getting it on audiobook through Audible, and I digested the thing like all in one weekend, and then I felt promptly overwhelmed. So I think your idea of going through it bit by bit and actually implementing probably some of the things is the right way to do that one. I ended up buying the paperback version because I like flipping back to it and figuring out which ones, I need to tackle or reread.
Yeah,
Yeah,
he's got
are you
some
a paperback
worksheets.
or are you like a Kindle kind of person?
We were just
Look
talking about
behind
this the
her.
other,
Look on
I
her table
know.
behind her there.
So I'm trying, Tara's talking me into this of like maybe embracing the Kindle a little more. It's just because I read before bed and I don't like any sort of screen or device in front of me. And it's kind of unwinding after a long day with the kids. So there is something about the paperback, but I'm really like, this is the most tame book section of my. For those of you who can't see, it's like my backdrop of books, but my bedroom has a lot more, and eventually I will run out of space. So I probably should do
Hey,
the Kindle.
I'm big on Kindle, but I always like think if there was like an apocalypse and there was no way for me to charge, like I'd have no books to read.
Yeah.
I'd be like, Aubrey, let me borrow some books.
You can come to my personal library, which I'll start having to just check things out because then maybe it will be more manageable. This would be
Hey.
perfect. Your apocalyptic library will be there.
Yeah.
Such a
The other
great
thing
name.
that's the other thing that struck me about Atomic Habits is the idea of making things easy so that you'll do them. So I'm looking like I have three water bottles on my desk that I fill up in the morning so that I will be sure to drink water otherwise. Yeah.
That's smart.
So those are some things, and I mean it applies back to even like the Canva stuff we're talking about, right? Like make it easy so that you'll do it. That's what Canva kind of targets. So,
So
all
good.
right. Next question. And maybe this is obvious. I don't know. What's one app you couldn't live without? And it can't be Canva.
Oh, nuts. Okay. After Canva, I'll say that the app that I use the most on my phone is Instagram. So, a lot of what I do with design is social media graphics. So, trying to keep just a pulse on what's happening in social media world. And I would say, like, I definitely don't consider myself a social media expert, but what's happened is I've started to partner with a lot of social media managers. So I'm learning so much from them, as well as virtual assistants. They use Canva so much to help their clients. And so, yeah, probably Instagram. If you looked at my screen time on my iPhone, I would be ashamed at how many hours I spent on Instagram.
Yeah, it's easy to
It's for
get
work,
sucked
though,
in.
I
And now
promise.
there's story. Yeah, now there's stories too, which I don't know how people do so many of those because it takes me forever to do that. You must get really fast at it, but it's must be an
Oh my gosh.
acquired skill.
Watching my niece and nephew do it, they're like flim, 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 and like it's done like so fast. They are like Instagram gurus. Takes me a little bit longer, but I hate that screen time report that your phone gives you because every t week I'm trying to beat it, like to get it down. And some week it says it increases and I get so upset. I'm like, oh man, how did that happen? So I'm
Yeah, I'm
sure
just
with
like, don't
Instagram,
judge.
come on. But I do recognize it's trying to make me a better, more balanced person. Now, final question. What is one great piece of advice you'd like to leave us with?
Oh man. Okay. I've got two things. I have to choose one or the other, right? Like I can't drop y'all with too much here, right?
Oh, no, you
You
can
can
do
do two
it.
if you
I
want.
do it all the time. I break the rules, and Tara just looks at me like, you broke another rule, but she's very kind.
Oh,
So,
I
yes, we're
Enneagram
kind and
type one ain't
embracing.
having it. Okay, I would say hear from the experts, but listen to your gut. And even in a conversation like this, the listener is hearing me kind of give my take on design, Canva, social media, But ultimately, like, they're going to know their audience much better than I do. They're going to understand the context for their business, for their school, for their organization. And so find the nuggets that will help you to succeed in where you're going. I think I've made this mistake in the past where I've leaned on experts when a situation came up and they gave me advice based on their specific leadership style. And when I went to implement that advice, it didn't go well for me. Even though I knew hearing the advice, I think that's good advice for them, but it doesn't resonate with like who I am or my leadership style. And so I learned some hard lessons through leadership that now in business I'm going, there's all of these gurus popping up and it's hard to discern who actually knows what they're talking about and who is just like trying to sell a course or something like that. So I listen, you know, I'll hear what the experts have to say, but I listen to my gut and go, okay, this feels like it resonates with the direction that I'm moving. And so I'm going to take these pieces of advice and experiment with them a little bit. But I don't take everything as gospel because I think that I've just been burned too many times. So that would be my advice for the listener. Just hear what I'm saying, but it's okay to trust your gut on this one. And then the other one, I'll just rip off from 12-week year because it's been so huge for me. Is that I can't control the outcomes, but I can control my actions. And so there are different goals that I have. And when things change, like even within my business, there are things that are just unpredictable that come up that I was like, oh man, now I'm not gonna hit my goal. Well, I can either freak out about that or I can take control of what I can control, which are my actions. What am I going to do about it? And it takes the pressure off. So I'm not like freaking out about that goal that I set that now I'm like, oh, it was way too lofty. I'm never going to get that, you know, I'm a failure. But no, there are some things that I can do. I can pivot. There are people that I can lean on. There are experts that I can ask their advice and see if it aligns with where I'd like to go. And so not getting so hung up on the outcome, but just figuring out what you can control and take ownership of that.
Yeah, that's great. We talked about 12-week year offline a bit too. So I'm a disciple of Brian Moran, who wrote that book, as well as James Clear. I think I read them like right one after the other. And for anybody who doesn't know that book, yeah, the 12-week year it's a great way to approach your personal and professional goals. So thanks for sharing that. Yeah. We're so glad that you joined us. This was really fun. I can't wait to dive back into Canva and give it a look at some of those templates. Yeah. Roger, where can people find you online? I mean, Instagram, obviously.
Yeah, you can find me on My Social Designer everywhere, mysocialdesigner.com, Instagram, My Social Designer. Just I'm everywhere. I believe in virtual real estate, so I grab it anytime it comes up.
I love it. Excellent. I love it. And thank you so much. You gave us so much to think about and also some great words of advice. I really appreciated that, especially that last one about listening to your gut. So thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
Bye.
See you.
Thanks for joining us on the Mindful School Marketing Podcast.
We'd love it if you pop into iTunes and leave a review, 5-star preferred. Let us know how you like the show. It helps us improve what we're doing and helps others find us too.